My name is Mohi Elbanna, Professor of General Surgery, NCHAMS Medical School. The title of this lecture is Blood Transfusion Part 2. By the end of this lecture, you should be able to outline the indications of blood transfusion, outline the handling and storage consequences, mention blood products and their indications, explain blood transfusion volume, discuss the complications of blood transfusion, apply acquired knowledge on virtual case scenarios and clinical situations. In the previous lecture, we discussed the aims of blood transfusion practice, cross-matching, storage and handling of blood and blood products, the types of blood and blood products. The main indications of blood transfusion are acute blood loss and severe anemia. Blood transfusion for blood loss. Hemorrhage can be classified according to the rate and volume of blood loss. Loss of less than 1500 milliliters, that's 30% of blood volume, requires crystalloids, colloids. Loss of 30% to 40% of blood volume requires red cell transfusion. More than 40% loss is or equivalent to 2 liters requires a rapid replacement by crystalloids, colloids, followed by urgent blood and blood products. Blood transfusion and elective surgery. Attitudes to transfusion in elective surgery are becoming more conservative. There is a shortage of blood and blood is expensive. In elective surgery, patients fall into one of 3 categories. Transfusion not anticipated, as in cases of hernia repair. Transfusion possible but unlikely, as in cases of colectomy. Transfusion is probable, as in cases of major arterial reconstruction. For patients in the second category, blood should be sent for ABO and rhesus grouping and antibody screening and serum retained for compatibility testing if required later on, group and save. For patients in the third category, the required amount of blood is prepared before surgery according to the hospital protocol. If a further transfusion is required more than 72 hours later, a new blood sample must be tested for new antibodies. Blood transfusion for anemia. The cause of anemia should be found and corrected. Traditionally, blood transfusion is indicated if hemoglobin level is less than 8 grams per deciliter. However, recently, this number has been reviewed and the new guidelines state 7 grams per deciliter as the cutoff point for transfusion. Generally, surgery can be performed safely if hemoglobin is 10 grams per deciliter or more. There are hazards and complications of blood transfusion. They include febrile, non-hemolytic transfusion reactions, hemolytic reactions, allergic reactions, infection, immunosuppressive effect, fluid overload, transfusion-related acute lung injury, and delayed transfusion reactions. Febrile non-hemolytic transfusion reaction is caused by leukocyte incompatibility. It is rare since universal leukodepletion of blood products has become the standard practice. Febrile reactions are more common in multi-transfused or paras women. The clinical picture of FNHTR is a temperature rise greater than 1 degree and shivering during or after transfusion. Symptoms usually subside after stopping the transfusion for 15 to 30 minutes and administering antipyretics and antihistaminics. Hemolytic reactions. Almost all hemolytic reactions are caused by human error and incompatible transfusion. With major ABO incompatibility, massive hemolysis may be fatal. Minor incompatibility causes a lesser degree of hemolysis. The clinical picture includes fever, dyspnea with chest tightness, severe loin pain, hypotension, acute oligoric renal failure, jaundice, DIC with spontaneous bruising and hemorrhage. Blood tests confirm the diagnosis. There is hyperbilirubinemia, positive Coombs test demonstrating a new antibody, hemoglobinemia, and hemoglobinuria. Treatment of the hemolytic reaction includes stoppage of the transfusion immediately, resuscitation of the patient. We need to treat oliguria by osmotic diuresis, sometimes with a loop. Allergic reactions have clinical manifestations of fever, pruritus, skin rashes, and rarely anaphylaxis. Mild reactions are treated by slowing or stopping the transfusion for 30 minutes and giving antihistamines. Recurrent severe allergic reactions are treated by antihistamine pre-medication. In all the cases, we need to investigate the cause. Infection may arise from three sources: the donor, blood storage, transfusion set, or cannula. Infections from donor blood. Donor blood can now be screened for most significant transmissible infectious agents. Many tests rely on detecting antibodies to viruses and cannot identify recent diseases or donor in a chronic latent carrier state. Transmitted infections include viral infections as hepatitis B, C, D, cytomegalovirus, Epstein-Barr virus, and HIV, bacterial infections as syphilis and brucellosis, protozoal infections as malaria, Chagas disease, and babesiosis, and prions as variant Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. Hepatitis and HIV. Hepatitis B occurs because hepatitis B surface antigen may be absent early after infection. Hepatitis C is a window for HCV antigen to appear after infection, may be up to 3 months. The window for HIV antibodies to appear is 1 to 3 months. The immunosuppressive effects of blood transfusion are controversial, may affect recurrence of certain cancers, and may be beneficial for some patients, for example, renal transplant. Fluid overload is not a problem for healthy adults. It may occur in cardiac patients or if they receive large volumes of blood transfusion. Transfusion-related acute lung injury is acute, rapid onset, shortness of breath, and cough following a plasma-containing product, usually from a multiparous woman donor. The reaction is due to reaction between the donor antibodies and patient's leukocytes. That's why nowadays fresh frozen plasma is only sourced from male donors. We have certain rare delayed transfusion reactions. They are post-transfusion purpura, which is very rare and potentially fatal, more common in females, and is caused by platelet-specific alloantibodies. Symptoms usually occur about a week after transfusion, with the patient developing thrombocytopenia and bleeding. They are treated with high doses of intravenous immunoglobulins with favorable response in around 85%. The second delayed transfusion reaction is transfusion-associated graft versus host disease. When transfused donor lymphocytes recognize the recipient cells as foreign, even though compatible with the recipient, and initiate graft versus host disease. Patients most at risk are those with defective cell-mediated immunity. Irradiation of blood products is needed to inactivate T cells likely to cause graft versus host disease in susceptible patients. The mortality rate of this reaction is 75 to 90%, as we do not have effective treatment. Please be ready with your questions in the next face-to-face session.